立法會主席
President of the Legislative Council
質詢，今次。
Questions. Apart from six oral questions for this meeting, the Honourable Hon Gary FAN will ask an urgent oral question under Rule 24, Bracket 4 of the Rules of Procedure. After the Honourable Gary FAN has asked the urgent question and the Secretary for Transport and Housing has given reply to the question, members may ask supplementary questions. Members who wish to ask supplementary questions, please press the request to speak button as early as possible so that we can estimate when to start oral question number one. Having regard to the situation, I will as far as possible allow members to ask supplementary questions if they so wish. To allow more members to ask questions, questions raised by members should be as concise as possible. Members should not make arguments when asking questions. Honourable Gary FAN. President, before I ask my urgent question, I'd like to raise a point of order. You said that you would allow more members to ask questions as they so wish. I'd like to ask, is it that all members who have pressed the button to ask supplementaries and are staying in the queue will all be allowed to ask supplementaries? I will have regard to the situation and then I will adjust the time. You mean you will allow 1 hour or 2 hours? Well, I will have regard to the situation. Please now ask your urgent question. On the early morning of the 16th of this month, staff members of the MTR Corporation Limited completed the tests on a new signaling system for the MTR Chin Wan line and reverted to the existing system. However, they found that the signalling systems of the Chin Wan line, the Island line, and the Kwun Tong line all broke down simultaneously and could not be fixed before the first trains commenced service. The signalling system of the Cheung Kwan O line also broke down later. As a result, all these four railway lines could only provide limited service during the morning rush hours. This also caused severe knock-on effects and chaos on road traffic, affecting hundreds of thousands of members of the public. In this connection, will the government inform this council, given that MTRCL is gradually replacing the signalling systems of various railway lines, whether the government and the MTRCL will take immediate measures to prevent the relevant works from causing disruption of railway services and whether they will expeditiously formulate contingency plans, including alternative public transport services, to deal with large-scale disruptions of railway services. Secretary for Transport and Housing. Thank you, President. President, during the morning peak hours on October 16th, train service of the MTR Island Chinwan Kuntong and Chuankwan O lines suffered from service disruption. Although train service was not suspended, the carrying capacity of the four railway lines were reduced with limited train service with intervals of about 12 to 15 minutes. The incident covered a wide area affecting numerous passengers. The government and the MTRCL are sparing no efforts to look into the cause of the incident in order to avoid recurrence. Regarding the question raised by the Honorable Gary Fan, I will reply from the following aspects. In the early morning of October 16th, MTRCL conducted testing of the new signaling system along the Chinwan line, during which both the new and existing systems functioned normally. Before 5 a.m., the MTRCL switched back the signaling system to the existing one to prepare for train services. At 5:28 a.m., the Operations Control Center found that trains on the island, Chinwan and Kuntong lines, were unable to receive target speed instructions. Out of safety concern, trains on these three lines were switched to manual mode at reduced speed from the start of train service at around 6 a.m. During the period, the overspeed protection function of the trains continued to function in ensuring railway safety. The engineering personnel of the MTRCL immediately carried out emergency repair works. Having failed to recover the system, the engineering personnel then attempted to reboot the signaling system of the respective lines one by one. At 5:52 a.m., before the first train commenced service, the MTRCL informed the Emergency Transport Coordination Center, or ETCC, of the Transport Department, TD, and issued amber and red alarms consecutively according to the established contingency plan, requesting other public transport operators to enhance services. During the emergency repair works, the Chuankwan O line also suffered from signaling fault and trains were switched to manual mode at reduced speed. Upon rebooting the computers at the stations along the four railway lines, emergency repair works were completed one after another by 11:45 a.m. and train service gradually resumed to normal frequencies. Upon receiving MTRCL's notification, taking into account the severity of the incident, the ETCC of TD upgraded its operation mode to Level 2, led by directorate staff of TD, and deployed additional staff to coordinate other public transport to provide emergency support. The center urged MTRCL to disseminate information to passengers and closely monitor and manage passenger flow in stations. It also contacted and requested franchised bus and tram operators to enhance service and send additional staff to assist passengers to queue up. With TD's coordination, 11 routes of franchised buses, 24 additional trams, and the Star Ferry enhanced its service during the incident to assist in picking up affected passengers. During the period, TD disseminated information to the public through the media, its website and mobile applications, and also deployed personnel to the most affected stations in order to monitor the situation. The EMSD also deployed personnel to MTRCL's operating control center and the Kowloon Bay Central Equipment Room to observe train operations and monitor the repair works. During the incident, the MTRCL deployed an additional 400 staff members to assist passengers, including conducting crowd control at stations. MTRCL also updated the public on the relevant information through media briefings, its mobile application, and broadcast stations and inside train compartments. During the incident, ticket gates of each affected station were switched to a specific mode so that passenger fare was not deducted. According to the initial investigation by the MTRCL, the incident was likely caused by operation and data processing of the existing signaling system software, which did not run smoothly. After resetting, all systems along the lines returned to stable operation. Based on the above-mentioned initial investigation findings, the EMSD has requested the MTRCL to conduct and continue in-depth investigation while conducting an overhaul on the related equipment of the signaling system and submit a detailed report in 2 months. The MTRCL has set up an investigation panel. It will arrange overseas and local experts to assist in the investigation and conduct a comprehensive review on the system with the signaling system supplier. Directions of the detailed investigation include data processing synchronization arrangements of the signaling systems undertaken by the two suppliers, whether there are any potential software compatibility problems, and whether the interconnection and communication of the railway lines were smooth. The EMSD will continue to monitor the investigation work. The TD will also review the existing contingency plan, including the arrangement of free shuttle buses by MTRCL during the incident, and whether there is room for other public transport operators to enhance service during the incident in order to improve the handling of similar incidents in future. However, it should be noted that shuttle bus service is an emergency supplementary measure with limited carrying capacity. It will be subject to factors such as road conditions. Therefore, can hardly replace normal train service. Regarding the member's question on whether the incident is related to the signaling system upgrading project, according to the signaling system alarm log of the MTRCL, the incident indeed occurred after MTRCL switched back the signaling system to the existing one and had operated it for some time. There was no evidence showing correlation between the incident and the signaling system upgrading project. That said, the MTRCL has further strengthened its monitoring and maintenance of the existing system when testing the new signaling system and has deployed additional personnel to stand by a station's signaling equipment room to expedite the repair works. Separately, the EMSD has discussed with the MTRCL to temporarily segregate the interconnection of railway lines to avoid them being affected by one another under similar incidents. As mentioned above, the EMSD and MTRCL, including the expert panel set up by the MTRCL, will review whether the incident was indeed not related to the signaling system upgrading project when conducting the in-depth investigation. Thank you, President. Honorable Gary Fan. The Secretary did not answer this part of my question, and that is under monitoring by the government. The emergency feeder services were insufficient, and this was not provided on the 16th of October. The MTRCL has 10 feeder buses on standby. Why is it that not even one was deployed on that day? And the emergency arrangement was such that there should be 7 emergency feeder buses for 30 to 45 minutes. And if it is 60 to 90 minutes, there should be an additional 40. And if it is after 2 hours, altogether 100 emergency feeder or shuttle buses should be provided. Why is it that under your monitoring on the 16th of October, the MTRCL did nothing like that? And is it that this level of service, in fact, will not be able to tackle similar incidents in future? Secretary, thank you for the supplementary. Indeed, when this incident occurred, the MTRCL and the government would discuss with public transport operators. As I said, with regard to franchised buses, 11 routes deployed 75 buses to improve service, and in fact, increasing the capacity of those 11 routes by 40%. But we understand, compared to the train, buses cannot provide the same kind of capacity. At the same time, we also communicated with the tramway company and also the ferry company in order to provide more service. Mr. Fan said that there was no provision of free shuttle bus by MTRCL on that day. That is a fact, and we have followed up with the MTRCL. Now, whether their arrangement was the best, we had our own comments on that, and we will seriously follow up the matter with the MTRCL. Normally, the shuttle bus is providing point-to-point service. Say, for example, if there is disruption of service between certain stations, then the shuttle bus service will be provided from one station to another. But on that particular day, four lines were affected. We thought that anything that could help passengers travel should be done. That was our attitude. And I believe we have the same objective as members here. We will follow up with the MTRCL. As I mentioned, the TD will take another look at emergency transport arrangements for the future. We will go back and look into that. Thank you, Mr. Ben Chan. Thank you, Chairman, President. The Secretary said that on that particular day, the MTRCL did not arrange for franchised buses or shuttle buses to provide service. Passengers who left stations were at a loss as to what they could do because all the roads were congested and people were flooding the streets. There are many things that should be reviewed in the contingency arrangement, but today we don't have MTRCL representatives here, so we could not ask them. However, the signaling tests will continue, Mr. Secretary. And I'd like to ask you if this indeed continues and there are similar risks. What are those risks? Have you evaluated the level of risks? If a similar incident should occur, what will be your contingency plan? Since it's so widespread, would you ask employers, for example, to give a holiday to their employees on that particular day? Secretary, thank you, Mr. Chen, for the supplementary. We said that with regard to that incident, we had communication with the railway subcommittee and we instructed the MTRCL to complete the in-depth investigation as soon as possible. Next week, they have to come to the railway subcommittee to give members a detailed account. Mr. Chan asked whether a similar incident could occur and would we be able to take better contingency measures. From what we understand from the initial investigation, and according to information from the MTRCL, there is no evidence that this incident had anything to do with the new signaling system. And also the two suppliers, Elstone and Siemens, and also the supplier for renovating the system on Chin Wan Line, they have confirmed that there is no connection between the incident and the existing and new signaling systems. However, the EMSD will do follow-up work to confirm that kind of remark and also to confirm whether the initial investigation result is accurate. The EMSD has instructed the MTRCL to disconnect the various railway lines so that there will not be another incident that would involve all four lines. We hope this can give you some confidence. And in our daily work and our monitoring work, we will urge the MTRCL to communicate with the TD every day before they start service in the morning in order to ensure that this will not occur, and if anything should be disseminated to the public, we would want to do it as early as possible. As to whether people should go to work in such an incident, the SAR government has said on many occasions that under our present rules and laws, every time we will appeal to employers to be understanding towards employees who have to go to work in such a situation and that they should be people-oriented in treating the situation. Of course, we don't want a similar incident to occur, but if indeed there will be any more delay caused by public transport, our attitude is to disseminate the message as early as possible and also to deploy other public transport in order to alleviate the possible impact. Ms. Tanya Chan. Thank you, Mr. President. At hand here, I have delays on MTRCL in this year, 2018, and the light blue patches show delays for more than 30 minutes.
And these include incidents during rush hours. And this list does not contain any incidents involving the LRT. We know that there is a so-called penalty system involving the MTRCL. Ms. Tanya Chan, this is not the time to express comments. May I remind members that this is an urgent question in relation to the possible railway incidents arising from the replacement of the signaling system of the MTRCL. Other issues should be taken up on other forums. Well, in the past, we had incidents causing delays of up to 10 hours, but the penalty system would refer to the service which has suffered the most severe disruption. For example, 83 minutes in one incident resulted in a penalty of $2 million only. President, I have to set out the background. So there was an incident causing delay of up to 10 hours, and this time it was the most serious incident after 2014. In Singapore, I'm setting out the basic background information for the secretary to consider. In 2014, Singapore has changed its system. The highest penalty would be the total ticket receipt, 10% of total ticket receipts. And we have made reference in the past, we have made reference to Singapore's system. So are you going to impose a heavier penalty according to the RP 26 bracket 4? The supplementary questions should not be on subjects which are not related to the main question, and as officials answering the question can choose whether to answer the questions or not. Well, I've jotted down the questions that we would consider those issues after the meeting. Mr. Alvin Yang, the four railway lines all broke down this time, affecting everyone in Hong Kong. And it said that 400 people were deployed to help the MTRCL by the TD. But obviously, this was not good enough in offering assistance to the affecting traveling public. So would the administration in the past or in the future come up with something different? And on what basis would the number of additional MTRC staff be deployed to assist passengers in such an incident? The SAR government has this policy of public transport first, with the railway as our backbone. This has to do with our smart mobility concept. And the railway system has a big carrying per capita, and it's a green mode of transport. So 12 million passengers on a daily basis rely on public transport. 90% of the share goes to public transport, and 5 million passengers on average use the railway lines and the services there. But we need other services as well, such as bus service account for 4 million passengers in the share of passengers. And in busy areas, we also have taxis and minibuses offering concurrent routes and services to serve the traveling public. As I've said, if we look at the carrying capacity, the train would be able to carry 2,000 people and a bus just 200 passengers. If the roads are congested, what we can do is to minimize the impact of the railway incident. As regards how many people should be deployed to help the members of the public, I understand that on that day, the MTRCL redeployed the people. They redeployed people working on other duties to help passengers direct. As for the number of people to be deployed, we will leave this to the MTRCL. The most important thing is to provide clear information to passengers within the stations affected by the incident so that they may want, the passengers may choose other modes of transport if they want. But whatever we do in terms of deploying additional manpower or providing alternative support service, what we can do is just to mitigate the delays on deploying other service and the early dissemination of information, and so that people can make preparations. These will be the things that we will look into in the future. Mr. Kuang Chun-Yu, many people have criticized the government for imposing a less than sufficient and insufficient penalty on MTRCL. I think people are asking that the most direct way to penalize the MTRCL is to pay the passengers back, and so that it will not just be required to provide half fare on a future date. May I also remind members that supplementary questions should be related to the May one. Secretary, on the question of penalty and the fare reduction to be offered by the MTRCL, I know the MTRCL is working on this. Next week, when MTRCL come to the subcommittee meeting, we'll ask the MTRCL to give an account. We are following up the matter very seriously with the MTRCL. We'd like to reach a consensus with the MTRCL. We'd like the MTRCL to positively respond to concerns expressed over the incident. They will be required to give a full account in the subcommittee meeting next week. Mr. Michael Tin, Secretary, this is an urgent question. Well, too urgent in my view. Perhaps the MTRCL hasn't submitted a report to you. Let me help you out here. I understand that the MTRCL replaced the signaling system 20 years ago. Well, you are here to ask questions. You're not here to speak on behalf of MTRCL. When they introduced the new system, they have also enhanced the existing system with software compiled by their own people. So that's the problem. So now they will not be using the enhanced system. They will revert back to the old system that they had 20 years ago, and now there was segregation of the system for the railway lines. So there will be problems in the future. If on that day, well, there were people who had those people did not have knowledge about the old system. Those who knew had already retired. In Singapore. They also had a project to replace a 20-year-old signal system, so the service collapsed right away. In the past, we would send people to the software production company to test out the system. to debug the system for 3 months so as to make sure that when this new system is up and running, there will be no problem. I understand the MTRCL is no longer doing this. Would you urge the MTRCL to send a team of their people to do this debugging exercise for 3 months? So therefore, the new signaling system for Chuen Wan Lai, that there will be no need for us to ask another urgent question. Well, Mr. Tin is really an expert of railway. But I need to clarify a point here. The signaling system in Hong Kong is different from that of Singapore. But the comments are noted. On the 16th of October, what happened to the signaling system? The MTRCL has got some preliminary findings. We have asked MTRCL to seek expert advice and reconfirm it. And we have asked AMSD to seriously evaluate whether the findings are really accurate. So Mr. Tin's comments are noted. And then at the subcommittee meeting next week, we would respond to such issues in greater detail. Secretary, you haven't responded to my main question. Are you going to ask the MTRCL to send a team of their people to do the debugging exercise for 3 months? Otherwise, we are going to have problems in the future. As I've said, we have heard Mr. Tin. We have noted the suggestions. The Secretary has mentioned smart mobility, and now there's nothing smart with four lines out of service. This is not the first time we have a total collapse of the railway service. Many people did not receive the information, and they were trapped in the MTR station or trains, and they could not go, they could not leave, and they were stuck for hours. Of course, they were not very happy about this. Secretary, do you have any requirements on or standards imposed on such a contingency plans or on the part of the MTRCL? And if the contingency plan does not work, for example, there were no buses offered, would you take this into account in the penalty assessment? And if the management hasn't been able to do a good job, would you consider also docking their pay or bonuses? In respect of service delay, MTRCL has got a plan, and they need to take action according to the plan immediately when an incident has occurred. If they believe that the delay would cause a time delay of more than 8 minutes, and if this up to 20% or more than 20% of the service would be affected, they need to issue an amber warning when the delay would be such that 25% of the service would be affected or the frequency would be exceeded by 25%, they would need to issue a red alarm. At the same time, they have to inform the TD's Emergency Transport Coordination Center so that other public transport operators can be alerted and service enhanced to help passengers. As regards whether the MTRC did a good, adequate job this time during the incident, I would like the MTRCL to give a full account at the subcommittee meeting next month. I understand people are angry about the contingency plan and the service disruption. We'll talk to the MTRCL on how to ensure that service will not be disrupted in a similar way. But of course, we need to look at the penalty system. And we have to ensure that the penalty is commensurate with the fault. And whatever we do, we should not bring pressure to bear on the personnel doing the repair, and as a result, affecting train service. We would let members know more about our ideas in due course. Mr. Charles Moore, apart from service disruption, people are equally concerned about the unknown costs because the MTRCL changed the story that after the incident, and we have seen an increasing number of railway incidents recently. Secretary, you said that this has got nothing to do with the upgrading or the replacement of the signaling system. They have got a panel looking into this, and the incident happened before and after the testing of the signaling system. How can you rule this out at this moment? Second, I want to talk about the expert panel. According to the reply, the expert panel would involve local and overseas experts in the investigation, and the suppliers would offer full support to the work, to the investigation. Can you tell us the timetable, who will be involved? Although this is led by the MTRCL, there's also the need to inform the public. And also, what's the role of the administration and the EMST? Are you also on the panel? It said that the EMST will continue to monitor the investigation. Does it mean that you are not you're not part of the panel and you just wait for the investigation to be completed by the MTRCL? Or are you going to participate in the investigation so as to speed things up? Mr. Moore, you have asked quite a number of questions. Secretary, you may wish to reply to one of them. Mr. Moore asked why we are so sure that the incident had nothing to do with the new signaling system. I said in the reply that in the process of testing the new signaling system, that was done, and then they reverted back to the signaling system. It was found okay, and then there was an incident after that. At the MTRCL, and the supplier of the signaling system, and also the supplier providing the transitional service, as well as EMSD, the colleagues, have conducted some preliminary investigation. Of course, we cannot say this 100% sure, but according to existing information, we are quite confident that the incident on the 16th of October had nothing to do with the transition to the new system. Having said that, we have asked the EMSD to re-look into the data in greater detail. As for the expert panel, there will be two overseas experts and one local expert, Mr. Michael Hamling, Mr. Bruce McDougall, and Professor Ho Shi Lau are on the panel. EMSD will act as an independent expert to the administration. It would scrutinize the findings of the investigation conducted by the MTRCL. So EMSD is a party independent to the process, so that EMSD will not be affected, will not be unduly swayed by EMSD, by MTRCL. We will make sure that the findings will be fair and accurate, and we will urge the MTRCL to give a full account of the investigation to the public. Mr. Winston Chan, well, the response plan was very poorly arranged. On that day, many people were at a loss. They didn't know what transport they would take, so it was poorly arranged. When something happens to a railway line, then other services cannot be provided in good time. So I would like to ask the administration how coordination with other public transport operators be enhanced. Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Chang, for your question. Well, I agree with Mr. Chang. But if our railway system grinds to a halt, what can we do? It takes a lot of wisdom to come up with a solution. We have 12 million passengers on a daily basis. 5 million of them would use the the railway will marshal all the resources in the public transport sector to mitigate the impact. For example, 4 million by buses, 2 million by taxi, and 1 million by taxi, 2 million by minibuses, 4 million by buses. So that's 7 million. We can also enhance tram services. We advise people to use the Western Harbour Crossing or use the ferry for cross-harbour journey so as to relieve the pressure on other modes of public transport for services. But it would be difficult to cope with 12 million utilizing the capacity of 7 million.
In the 2014 Railway Development Strategy, there will be planning and other strategies that can provide relief. Say we are talking about the East Kowloon Railway Line, it can balance the Kwun-tong Line, and also we have the Island North Extension, so it will support the Island Line. All these plans, when completed, will help such situations. But before these railway lines are completed, we will think of other ways and means to try to do more to provide relief if indeed such an incident should recur, so that there will be less impact on the public. Mr. Au Nok Hin. Thank you, President. When Mr. Chan spoke, he admitted that the MTRCL did not provide shuttle buses, and you said that you had your own comment. And I agree for giving us the information about the ETCC, because I asked many questions on that, and you eventually told me that it upgraded its operation mode to level 2. And the TD's guide says that if there is disruption of the railway line, there should be an action checklist for other public transport services. In other words, if different railway lines break down, there should be this action checklist that can be activated. The MTRCL did not provide any shuttle bus service this time around. Are you admitting that someone did not act according to the established procedures? Will you consider adjusting or revising this action checklist? Secretary, thank you, Mr. Au, for your supplementary. You mentioned level 2. This is the appropriate level in order to cope with an emergency. And as Mr. Au said, the MTRCL did not make use of emergency shuttle bus services. When I answered other members, I also said that if there are certain sections along the railway which are blocked, then the MTRCL will provide the shuttle bus service. But on that particular day, there were delays on the entire line and a few lines. So the shuttle bus service is not appropriate for that situation. And we said, of course, if there is more we can do in such a situation, we should all tap in that kind of resources in order to make traveling easier for passengers. We have made that comment to the MTRCL. Later on, if there is any railway incident at all, we must provide the best relief for passengers. He has already answered your question, Mr. Michael Look. Thank you, President. Why is it that in recent years there are so many railway incidents? If anything like that should happen, it means that something has broken down and you must repair it. I have received from the relevant union telling me that MTRCL wanted to save money and it wanted to be a profit-making kingdom, and it is cutting down on the budget for the maintenance and repair department, including manpower. I'd like to ask Mr. Chen whether he is aware of that. Have you looked into that? Because a lack of resources would lead to insufficient manpower. You deploy people to the new railway lines, but there are insufficient people working on the old railway lines. And the hardware is also getting old. I'd like to ask whether you can promise me here that you will urge the MTRCL to make sure that they have enough people on their maintenance and repair team, and also to pay the workers good salaries so that they can retain people, and so that there will not be so many incidents. Secretary, this has also deviated from the main question. You can choose to answer or not. Secretary, thank you. President, thank you, Mr. Luke, for your comment and also your question. From what we understand, with regard to asset renewal, the MTRCL is using $8 billion or more every year. As for recruitment, training, and deployment of staff, the MTRCL places a lot of emphasis on training and retention of manpower. The MTRCL has set up a railway academy targeting at quality and sustained development of train service. As for manpower level, remuneration, etc., as a huge enterprise in Hong Kong, we must not forget corporate social responsibility. We have expressed that view to the MTRCL on various occasions, and we hope that they will work more on CSR. Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Councillor Leung. Even as the Secretary said that the incident has nothing to do with the signaling system testing, you said that it was purely coincidental, but at least the MTRCL is guilty of not making enough preparations, knowing that there were risks, and so that the public were also not prepared. I'd like to ask the administration, after learning a lesson from this incident, will you require the MTRCL and also yourselves that later on, if there are more such tests and if there will be such risks, will you inform the Hong Kong public in advance? And what the contingency plans are for the various lines so that everybody will be prepared? Secretary. Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Chu, for the question. When the MTRCL installs and tests a new signaling system, well, I think that has been done for almost 2 years. Before the project was undertaken, the MTRCL explained to the public through the media that in the night when train service stops, the testing will be done, and then in the morning they will switch back to the new existing system. It's like switching brains, so to speak, in the night and switching back in the morning, and the risks are indeed very high. The MTRCL did a lot of risk assessment and also has looked into emergency response solutions. From our initial understanding, and also this is confirmed by the MTRCL, that this particular incident has nothing to do with the testing of the new system and the testing of the new system in view of its compatibility with the old system. Now, of course, with regard to this incident at the Railway Subcommittee meeting next week, we'll come back to give members a detailed account. Please wait for the statements of the MTRCL and the administration next week, and then you can make your further comments. My question was about giving notice in advance. It is not good enough to say 2 years ago that in the next few years you will do testing. We are talking about information the night before. Any supplement from you, Secretary? Well, I said over a year ago, we told the public that every night we are going to do the same thing. So basically, we have already done that about this project. Mr. Ray Chen, Secretary. All four lines were affected because of a failure in the signaling system. This was unprecedented. It is not just the railway lines, because all of a sudden, there were so many people who were dislodged. And look at the islands. There were too many people waiting for trams. And the two tram stations were merged into one. A few hundred people were waiting in the middle of the carriageway, waiting for trams. It was very dangerous. This was indeed a traffic disaster. But the TD said that this was not at the level of disaster. We believe that you were very callous in saying that. The public were asking, do you want somebody to die before you call this a disaster? My question is, can you retract the statement that this incident involving all four lines was not at a disaster level? And also, what is your own definition of a disaster level incident? Secretary.
Thank you, President. I really thank Mr. Chan for giving me the opportunity to clarify. From the day of the incident until today, the administration, including the TD, did not make that statement. So on a factual level, the TD knew about the incident on that day, and we did our best to coordinate and mobilize other public transport in order to relieve the difficulties of the public. On that particular day, from media reports and also from our own observation on the streets, the public also had a lot of difficulties using other public transport. Mr. Chan said two tram stations were merged. We know that. As I was saying, there were disruptions on 3 to 4 lines, so the impact was huge and a lot of people were affected. In terms of the limit of capacity of other public transport, we could only do our best. But what is important is that the TD and the government responded to the incident, escalating it to the highest level. I hope the public can understand that actually the statement was not made by our colleagues. Okay, then can you answer me whether this incident was at a disaster level? Secretary.
Thank you, President and Mr. Chan. Amongst our emergency response measures, we do not have a level which is called the disaster level. Mr. Jeremy Tam. Well, you don't have a disaster level, but you do have the level 2. You said that the ETCC of TD upgraded its operation level to level 2. But actually, there is a level 3 for ETCC. Level 3 is for a big-scale incident, and also there should be coordination amongst departments so that there will be level 3 operation. In other words, there will be a joint coordination mode. I'd like to ask why you did not raise it to level 3 on that particular day. And on that day at the ETCC, who was the highest ranking official?
Secretary.
Thank you, President and Mr. Tam, for your question. At the ETCC of the TD, indeed, we have levels 1, 2, 3. Level 1 is normal daily operation. Level 2 is to take care of the situation we mentioned. Level 3, a serious incident. But usually it is about pre-planned situations. Say, for example, there will be the commissioning of important traffic infrastructure or response to a typhoon. Those are incidents that require advanced preparation. Now, what is the difference between level 2 and level 3? Let me explain to you. Level 2 means that we will liaise with the police, law enforcement agencies, and other public transport operators. The only difference with level 3 is that all representatives of public transport should be present at the ETCC so that communication can be stepped up. Now, on that particular day, since the incident happened without notice, our staff
already made use of mobile phones and other means of communication in order to mobilize the representatives of all public transport operators. Instead of inviting them to come to the ETCC, we already communicated with them direct, and we also asked them to go and direct the support service on the ground. There is a difference between level 2 and level 3, but then perhaps we should look at how we define them. But in any case, I can guarantee to you that on that particular day, whether or not it is a particular level, we have already done our very best in order to mobilize all resources to liaise with all public transport operators in an emergency mode in order to provide relief and support services.
Mr. Gary Fan, please take down that panel because I couldn't see members behind you. Well, your question has not been answered. What's the question that's not been answered? Well, yes, let me ask the question. Why didn't you raise it to level 3? Otherwise, level 3 would be meaningless. You have already put your question. Secretary, any supplement? Thank you, Mr. Tam, for your follow-up question. As I've said, it's a question of nomenclature, how you call it. I've explained the difference between level 2 and level 3, and I also said that on that day, our colleagues took certain action. I believe I've already answered Mr. Tam's question fully. Mr. Wilson Orr, thank you, President. All the four railway lines were down. Many people have complained. I was also affected at Tiu Kang Lang Station. Secretary, you stressed that every time when you had an incident, you would have put in place the contingency plan. So what has the MTRCL done in this regard? What's the division of labor between MTRCL and the administration? Because very often the plan did not work out well. Is there any room, or how can you improve the contingency plan? Thank you, Mr. Orr, for your question. Recently, in respect of MTR service and also MTRCL's response to the incidents, members have certain views. But if we look at the scope and the implication of such incidents, what we can do is to do the level best we can. As an observer, I would say that on that day or in previous incidents, and I'm not just talking about MTRCL or public transport operators, transport department colleagues, and the administration, and the business sector, and the general public, have all given us advice and done their part. For example, some organizations, some businesses offered a free shuttle service for people going to the NT. So different people have been chipping in to help ease the difficulties faced by passengers. But when the incident is of such a big scale, with the wide implications and impacts, I hope members will understand that everyone involved has done their best. I would say that's a very good level of accountability, but people are not happy. They are angry about the plan, and it's certainly we can ask the relevant organizations to improve the arrangements. Of course, we can ask the MTRCL to do even better next time, but there's a limit to everything. So I think we should give a suitable degree of
credit and appreciation to the public transport operators, MPLCL, and other people. I think we should be fair to all the people working in the MPLCL, especially frontline officers. Mr. Lam Chok Ting, last year we had an incident at Kun Tong Lai causing disruption for 10 hours. After that, we wrote to you to ask for a review of the penalty system. At that time, a 2 million fine was imposed. And the reply came, and you said you didn't want to change the penalty system, because otherwise the repair personnel would do the repair hastily. And now the secretary has said that you again asked the MTRCL to review the penalty system. Have you overruled yourself and have you changed your mind about the penalty system? On that day, you refused to review the penalty system. Was that a wrong decision on your part? Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Lam, for your comments. In the FAM context, the penalty system was reviewed in 2017. Recently, we had an incident. The public and the legislators here have expressed dissatisfaction. Of course, we need to appropriately respond to the case. Would it really be effective to increase penalties? And if we are to increase penalties, what should we do? Should we take away the director's fee, dock their pay? Or should we be confining ourselves to things that would not affect railway safety? Well, I have an open mind at this moment, and I welcome suggestions from everyone. But I hope we will not just be looking at the fine, the pecuniary punishment. It's more important that we look for the results. I thank members for the varied constructive views and suggestions. Having said that, I would personally monitor the review and investigation. And together with my colleagues in the THB and the Transport Department, we would take appropriate follow-up action. Well, my question has not been answered. When we asked the secretary adopted a certain position in respect of reviewing the penalty system, was that a wrong decision? As I've said, we would consider different factors in different cases as appropriate, because we are talking about two different cases, two different situations. I believe I've responded to that question already. Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, on the 16th of October, all the four lines broke down. According to the management of MTRCL, this was the first time. But many people like me think this will not be the last time. The secretary talked about the coordination, the efforts expended by the departments and between the public transport operators. What about communication with the public? Apart from a typhoon signal or the and also the rainy weather alarm, would you also give us a transport alarm system, such as an amber warning, yellow and red alarm, etc.? But this again has deviated from the main question. Well, within the government team, we'll certainly be forthcoming and transparent in informing the public of incidents. We have alarms for torrential rain and typhoon. As a matter of practice, we inform the public of all the relevant information through different means, such as a mobile app and social media. Our practice is in line with that of the observatory, and the coverage of the media is also the same. Well, your question is actually a deviation from the May question. I've already asked the secretary to answer your question. Mr. Leung Chi Chang, well, it's a disaster that that all the four railway lines broke down at the same time, and there was no way people could adequately respond to that. Would the public be assured if you deploy more people to help them, or you have more bus routes offering alternative service? Would they be assured by this? The time was, well, actually the incident happened before 5 a.m. and the government knew about that by 5:28 a.m. But the public didn't know. They still went to the MTR stations, and therefore we have a large number of passengers stranded there. Secretary, you said that through the mobile apps, you had informed members of the public. Is that really the case? You should strive to inform the public when there's an incident, so that they won't just go to the MTR station and stuck there without knowing that there's something happening. Thank you for your information and your question. Mr. Leung is about access to information. He's talking about access to information. The MTRCL was, of course, the first party to know about the incident, according to the information we have received. The MTRCL to inform the media, according to our records, at 5:52 a.m., MTRCL informed the TD, and TD make the information available to the public immediately. The TD rely on the mobile app, the smart mobility app, and also the media was informed. Can we improve what we have done? Well, this will be taken up in the review. And if the MTRCL is aware of certain situations whereby the people's will be affected, but in some cases, the advance warning would turn out to be not the case. So, and of course, when there's an incident, the MTRCL would certainly try to recover the system. Should the government be informed right away at the railway subcommittee meeting to be held next week, we will be responding to all these questions. We hope we'll be able to give you satisfactory answers. Dr. Priscilla Leung, the government should be held responsible for this problem with the MTRCL. I was affected as well. I walked from Prince Edward Station to Kowloon Tong, and there were people waiting there in vain for service to be resumed. Money may not be able to solve all kinds of problems. MTRC, usually would ask for certain bus routes be cut because of the commissioning of a new railway line, and because the service of others, public transport operators will not be viable after the commissioning of a new line. So when you calculate the penalty, you should not just look into the delay cost. Please raise your question. Many members have talked about the penalty system already. You should not just use this system as it is. You should ask the board of directors to be held accountable. If there are problems, what would the bus operators do to respond? And of course, this time, all the four lines were affected. There must be a contingency plan. Whenever we have a problem like this, other bus operators should be asked to work together with the MTRCL. And how can this be done? That's the number one concern of the public. Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Leung, for your questions. You talk about the monetary fine and the penalty system. We need to deal with it appropriately. We have to act within reason. We have to ensure that the system remains safe and the service quality will not be affected by what we do. As for the advanced notification system and communication, I have already said that we will look into how this should be improved so that we can reduce the impact on the traveling public. All these issues will be considered. On the question of imposing fine and also the overall penalty system, well, I know the MTRCL has expressed some gesture of goodwill and they will offer half fare on a day to be determined. I know the MTRCL is working out the details. Let's hope that in the Railway Subcommittee meeting next week, they will be able to tell you the details. Well, I agree that we need to impose a penalty when there's an incident. But the company should also be encouraged to show the corporate social responsibility and also to act in good faith and express goodwill to those affected by the incident. Dr. Cheng Chong Tai, Secretary, do you know that the MTRCL conducted a full system check on the 15th of October, the day before people go to work on a Monday? Why was it not done before within a long holiday? Did you know that they conducted the test on a work day? Why didn't they choose a long holiday or a weekend? It's a question of common sense.
Secretary, thank you. Mr. President, thank you, Mr. Chen, for his suggestion. Well, he asked whether we knew that on the 15th of October, a working day, that they were carrying out such a test. If Mr. Chen or Dr. Chen had listened to me, it was clear. Well, in relation to the signaling system replacement, it wasn't confined to the 15th of October. It started a year ago, and every night the change took place, the switch took place, and in fact the media had been informed so as to alert the public. A lot of publicity has been carried out. It's a matter of replacement of the signaling system. It is being done every day, and in fact after the service has stopped. The new signal system will be tested, and every morning before service resumes, then the existing system will be connected again. There is a test to make sure that things are smooth, and then service resumes. I hope I've set out the facts so as to respond to Dr. Jiang's point. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, thank you, Mr. President. The Secretary has said many times, whenever we have serious traffic incidents, well, in fact, we're talking about the failure of all the four MTR lines. It was said that all the other means of transport have been invoked. But in fact, you have only been referring to the different means of land transport so as to deal with the emergency. What about water transport? Why wasn't it included so as to assist with the situation when we had an emergency? Are you saying that water transport is not appropriate or it has never featured in your consideration? Secretary, thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Wu, for his question. Whenever we have an incident, in particular a traffic incident, we will liaise with all the traffic and transport operators. Now, for land transport, we do have many more operators and the service capacity is bigger, and that's why we've been focusing on land transport. For water transport, we do have a separate emergency plan, say, for example, for the Cheng Mao Bridge or the North Lantau Expressway are involved in any serious traffic incidents. We do have a plan drawn up with ferry operators so that citizens can be sort of carried to and from the pier near to the airport. In fact, on that very day, we did liaise with the Star Ferry to enlist their help. As I have already said, the rail lines involved harbour crossing service. In fact, on that particular day, Star Ferry service was also enhanced. Mr. Lau Kok Fun, thank you, Mr. President, for the disruption of train service on all the four lines. Many employees have been affected. We've been told that the railway would be the backbone. If that is the case, it means that the MTR plays a more important role. Now, of course, we talk about accountability, but today we haven't got anybody from the MTR. Now, penalty should be a way to deal with it, but then the fine is not going to commensurate with the seriousness of the problem. I think probably that's the reason why they have never learned any lesson. Now, of course, for punishment, for penalties, I don't think it should be confined to a financial fine. Are you going to find other ways to hold the MTR accountable for this? Secretary, thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Lau, for your question. For any operator providing public transport service, and in fact, Hong Kong is a major stakeholder in this regard. When we talk about corporate governance, when we talk about accountability, we do think that they are important issues. So other than the review that I've referred to, we need the MTRCL to look within their board of directors, and they should carry out a discussion among themselves, and then they should find out. Of course, we hope that this won't occur again, but in case this should occur again, they should know about the contingency measures. They should know what to do to minimize the inconvenience caused to the commuters. We have talked to the MTRCL staff, and we hope that in future we will discuss this matter within the board of directors. So for the board of directors of a corporation to study the matter and to come back with a positive reply, I think this is what we expect of a public corporation. Mr. Christopher Chung. Mr. President, now, the MTR has already apologized for this problem and has tried to give an account. But then this is the main mode of transport for the public. We have had the service disruption for all the four lines. It has caused a lot of traffic chaos. It has caused a lot of inconvenience to us. And this has tarnished our international image and has exposed the weakness in the governance of the MTRCL. Now, the MTR is not able to give priority to the convenience of the commuters. It is a matter of ignoring their social responsibility. Now, of course, the Hong Kong government is the largest shareholder of the MTRCL. Other than imposing a fine, I want to know what other ways you will resort to make sure that the corporation is held responsible for it. It is a major corporation. A small fine won't sort of have much deterrent effect. Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Cheng, for your comments and your question. Just now, Mr. Cheng has said that as far as the MTRC is concerned, he talked about its performance. He said that the corporation had ignored its social corporate responsibility. Let me explain this point. Well, the MTRCL, as well as the Board of Directors, when it comes to public interest, as well as the operation of the corporation, they are being taken seriously. And we will discuss the matter. We will urge the management to carry out improvements. Now, of course, the corporation will try to make improvements itself. It will also look at its CSR. It will continue to provide quality service to the public. As to the rest of his comments, we take note of them and they will be considered. Dr. Pierre Chen.
Thank you, Mr. President. In relation to the recent railway incidents, it exposed the serious problems with their governance. The Secretary talked about the penalty system, but I don't think it has got much deterrent effect. For the commuters, they have been affected by the massive disruption of the service. They have been affected, they went to work late, and in fact, their attendance bonus has been deducted by a few hundred or even $1,000. So when you consider your contingency plan, are you going to include the following factor? That is, the commuters whose attendance bonus has been deducted can have the loss claimed back from the MTRCL. I think this is a deviation from the original question.
Mr. President, I would like to thank Dr. Chen for his question. For the delays caused by service disruption on the part of public transport operators, well, in fact, we always try to play a coordinating role so as to minimize the inconvenience caused. And we also carry out a review every time so as to seek improvement in the future. Now, you talked about employees who have been delayed and as a result, the attendance bonus was deducted. Well, the view of the Hong Kong government is as follows. That is, irrespective of what happens, we hope that there will be good employer-employee relationship. If something happens and is beyond the control of individuals, we urge the employers to be understanding. We hope that the employers won't make it difficult for the employees and shouldn't deduct their wages. We have already instructed the MTR that is in relation to rail service delays, certificates should be issued to certify that service has been disrupted, and we hope that this will provide some kind of a proof to employees whose attendance has been affected so that the employers will be understanding and will not be deducting the wages or the so-called attendance bonus.
Mr. Abraham Shack.
I would like to declare
I'm a non-executive director of the MTRCL. Well, regarding the views made by the members today, I will certainly relate them to the board of directors. Let me say this, for the interface of the existing and the new signaling systems, the MTR has already said that it has got nothing to do with this factor. So, Secretary, please confirm this point. It seems that many people are saying that they are experts in this regard. I don't think he is sort of well-placed to talk as if he's an expert. It is politicizing the issue, and this is causing misunderstanding on the part of the public. Secretary, thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Sheikh, for your reminder. Well, just now, I have already commented on the initial finding of the review or investigation. Well, it has shown that this has got nothing to do with the testing of the new signaling system. So I hope that members of the legislature, as well as reporters who are covering this question will send out this message. This is important because lawmakers are also concerned, because had it been connected with the new signaling system, this may happen again. They are worried. I have made my point. Let me repeat. Regarding the contractors like Elstone and Siemens, as well as Elston, Thales, as well as the joint venture of the new system, they have all confirmed that it's got nothing to do to nothing to do with the signaling system. EMSD has also carried out an initial review, and it is believed that it is not related to this issue. But then we want to be 100% sure of the course, so we're still following this up. Let me say this once again and clearly, that is what happened on the 16th of October. We haven't established any connection, any direct connection with the old signaling system or the new signaling system. Ms. Yung Hoi Yen, well, the secretary has said that it has got nothing to do with the interface between the two signaling systems. How come that it took 6 hours to restore the system? Has something been hidden from us? Now, today you try to blame it on the system, you blame it on the mechanical failure, but I don't think the public find it acceptable. So we want to know whether there have been some communication problems or any man-made mistakes. I'd like to thank Ms. Yung for her question. I do agree with you entirely. Whether as a member of the public or as a member of this legislature, it took a long time to restore the system, and it has caused a lot of anger and dissatisfaction. In this incident, we have been following this up seriously, and for the time being, we have made inquiries with the MTR, and I personally did so. Please give us some time. In fact, come next week, we are going to have a meeting of the Subcommittee on Railway Service. We're going to give you a full account. In fact, something special did happen, and I hope that at the meeting of the Subcommittee on Railways, when we give a detailed account, you can then come to a fair judgment. So, and then at that time, you can give us further comments.
Question 1, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok.